Hello, Rob McNeely here, and I'm talking with Ben Furman, good friend of mine, psychiatrist from Helsinki, Finland. He's with his business partner, Tapani Ahola, who runs the Brief Therapy Institute of Helsinki. Yes. So, Ben, I remember I was coming to Helsinki at your invitation about 5 years ago. And you were coming back from Hawaii. You'd just been to a workshop on Ho'oponopono.
I actually participated in a meeting like that.
Okay. So could you say something about your experience then of participating in the experience of Ho'oponopono?
Yes, I have a good friend in Hawaii. Her name is Lauren Walker. She's actually a former lawyer. So she's a very experienced lawyer who kind of bailed out and stopped working as a lawyer and became interested in solution-focused therapy and started to develop ways of taking solution-focused therapy into the world of criminality and when people go wrong, when they become criminals, they go to jail, they go use drugs, they do all kinds of things that are bad for them. So she combined what is called restorative justice and solution focused therapy, and she succeeded in putting them together quite well. And one of the approaches was inspired by old traditions in Hawaii. This is a network meetings, and in all cultures in the world, there has always been the tradition where people get together under a big tree or in the park or somewhere, or in a meeting house in a Maraya in New Zealand. In Australia, they have this tradition too. In all over the world, there has always been a tradition of let's get together and let's talk about this together. Let's find solutions together. And so she revived that tradition, and she started to do such meetings with young offenders, with people in prisons who are re-entering society, re-entry it's called. So she became quite good at it, and she even created a structure to help other people do such meetings, to give it a cool Hawaiian name that actually refers to a meeting like that. So it's quite well known in Hawaii, and it's used by the traditional elders. So you kind of take ideas from traditional elders and you bring them into the social sphere or into the world of criminology.
And do you think it has any relevance in family therapy?
It has huge relevance in family therapy, and it's being used. But the problem is that our mental health systems and our criminal systems are very individually oriented. So we always try to fix the person, and we focus on individuals. And we are not used to getting together with people and sitting in meetings and letting everybody participate. This kind of democratic problem solving is alien. Our culture. So it takes a lot of time and effort to bring these naturalistic ideas of getting people involved and having, and you need some training how people who are only trained at working with individuals, they feel at loss when they have to conduct a meeting with, let's say, 20 people or 15 people or 8 people. And we are not talking about family therapy. We are talking about a little bit wider concept. That's why it used to be called network therapy, but it now has all kinds of weird names. Maybe I don't know what's wrong with the concept of network therapy, but that's what it used to be called when I was studying family therapy.
Okay. And there's a parallel process happening in your country, in Western Lapland. And two of your colleagues have been using what they call open dialogue since the 80s. They've been doing this for 30 years. And can you say something about your take on this? How this might be related to Ho'oponopono or restorative justice and solution focus?
It's all the same. It's like all over the world, there are people who are reviving, bringing back into our culture the idea that we sit together and everybody has a say. Okay. And they were quite successful in Western Lapland, in one hospital, in a small hospital, psychiatric hospital. They actually had a research project where all the newcomers, the new psychotic, the young people who had their first psychotic break, all of them were invited to have such a meeting, or actually it was part of the treatment plan. So there would be parents, there would be friends, there would be therapists from outpatient clinic, there would be maybe a teacher. You know, you kind of sit together in a circle, and the idea is that it's an open dialogue. So it's, the doctor is not the one who decides how this problem is going to be solved and what medication. The doctor is like just one of many. So it's an identity crisis for medical doctors to do something like an open dialogue, because they get a more marginal role. They are still experts, but they are just one of many people. And you typically open with a question like, what do you think has happened here? So everybody can also participate in the diagnostic process. And it's democratic. It's a democratic conversation about what should be done about this. How should we understand what's been happening? And in order to do something like that, we need like a new theory. We need new theoretical, you know, gurus to make us explain, because the medical model is so dominant in our field. But many people who have participated in this kind of meeting, they find it very pleasant, and they think it's revolutionary. So now open dialogue is spreading all over the world, and there are many research projects and a lot of doctors who are used to being the boss of the treatment process have written about their experiences, positive experiences of being one of many.
And from what I've read, it's not just different, but it's effective. You know, they're saying that they, in their locality, they are eliminating schizophrenia because they deal with the psychotic breaks. 85% have a good outcome with minimal medication, minimal hospital stays, and marvelous. It has to be something that we would hope would become more interesting. And to me, there is a link also between your pet, your baby of kid skills, because when you're working with kids, you are not the expert. You're asking questions. What skills do you need? So to me, there's a big overlap in all of these approaches, more democratic, more to do with healing rather than treating and fixing. I think it's a return to some traditional practices, which is overdue.
Community-based practices, yes.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
There has been many attempts to bring community-based practices into psychiatry, social work, and criminology, and they have mostly failed because the whole structure is so much based on individuals in our Western societies. But there are some signs that these kind of, we can call them maybe holistic approaches, or I would like to speak about community-oriented approaches. They are coming, and from New Zealand we have the family group conferencing, which has spread to Australia and Canada. So there are many many attempts, but there has always been many attempts. Yes. So we are just hoping that maybe in the current time and age we would have some possibility of success in spreading these ideas.
Well, I think, you know, if we can let more people know about it, that can add some, at least in some small way, to that. You know, the cynics say we just have to wait till the old people die. But I hope we don't have to wait that long, because some people live to be a good old age. Oh, Ben, that's so helpful to have this conversation clarify and emphasize what you're doing and what these other community-based systemic approaches have to offer, not just the expert treating the defective. Thank you so much for your insight and your sharing your experience with that, Ben.
My pleasure. Well,